Recorded Books presents Even If We Break by Marieke Nijkamp. Narrated by Jeffrey Brick, Amanda Dolan, Jer Adrian Lelliott, Cassandra Morris, and M.W. Cartozian Wilson.
Chapter 1.
Finn.
We're leaving the world behind. The narrow mountain road creeps higher, and with every step, Flagstaff and our small suburb of Stardust disappear a little farther into the distance. With every step, we're more alone. It's just the five of us. It's not a comfortable walk. The straps of my backpack dig into my shoulders, my binder is sweaty, and my crutches keep slipping on loose rocks. But it's a beautiful one. The muddy road first winds around a dark and ghostly lava field, then nestles between a whispering pine forest and steep cliffs. If only I could relax enough to appreciate it. But I keep my eyes on the ground. It's safer that way. And less painful, too. Are you okay? Carter falls into step with me, the two of us lagging behind the other three. Carter's the only one lugging a suitcase up this mountain, and it makes his pace more irregular than mine. His face is almost as red as his shirt, and he's sweating. The sun won't let us forget that it's summer. Please tell me you wore sunscreen, I say. He rolls his eyes. Yes, Dad. You like me a whole lot more than you like your dad, I joke, and immediately realize how mean it sounded. Carter flinches, then takes a deep breath and looks at me with something that's far too much like pity. And underneath is a gentleness I haven't seen in years, reminding me of the exuberant gamer he was our freshman year, before he became the son his parents wanted him to be. I'm glad you're here, dude. It's been a while. I don't know how to respond to that. I'm not sure I'm glad. A weariness has settled in my bones and my joints, and it refuses to come out. At least this is the last time we'll come together as a group. Too much has changed. Some friendships aren't meant to last. We've outgrown one another. There's too much hurt and history between us. But Ever wants us to try one last time, and forever, I'll do anything. Even if it means pretending everything's okay and putting costumes and characters over the cracks between us. Even if it'll break me. Even if it'll break all of us. I glance toward the front of the group where Ever navigates the road. There with Leva, and the sight of her perfectly styled hair and flawless smile makes me tense up. Pain stabs at my legs and radiates to the rest of my body. If Ever's why I'm here, Leva's why I wouldn't be. Carter is unperturbed by my silence. So, what do you think Ever prepared? I mean, we all know this game will be another murder mystery. Our characters are only good at solving murders, but this is our last weekend together. It must be something special. Do you think it'll be our boss fight? Take down the BBEG? They've been secretive for weeks. Although so much of me doesn't want to be here, I can't help getting drawn back into our game, into the world of Gonfalon. I missed this. But I continue my silence, trying desperately not to care. Carter keeps talking. We have the perfect location for it. Have you heard the ghost stories about this mountain? Apparently they go back for decades, centuries. Do you think Ever will weave some of that into our story? You know, for full immersion? It would definitely make this weekend memorable. I can't help myself. Ghost stories, huh? This doesn't seem like a haunted place. The mountain is green and blossoming under the summer sun. The foliage still smells of rain and the after effects of a storm. Birds chirp, eagles call, and every part of it is so tranquil it chafes. Only the road itself is imperfect, scarred by a year of minor quakes. Mass murders, disappearances, strange music coming from the shadows. The last thing the murderer's victims heard before he killed them was a music box melody. He looks up at the mountain and grins. People die on this mountain, Finn. You sound way too excited about that. Besides, if people died, how did anyone know the music box was the last thing they heard? Wouldn't it be fun to play through the night and then meet actual ghosts? No. This is exactly why Fatima, my therapist, says white people die in haunted houses. We have no nose for danger whatsoever. Where's your sense of adventure? I roll my eyes. Where's your sense of self-preservation? Come on. You don't think anything would actually happen. Underneath my crutch, a small pebble skids off the path, and I take a second to reposition myself. No, I don't think anyone actually believes in ghosts, not even nerds like you who go to the library to dig up local haunts. Carter smirks. He's your average, pasty white, all-American boy, with sparkling blue eyes and curly blonde hair. I'll have you know, I will always take nerd as a compliment, and in this case, I didn't go to the library. Leva mentioned it the other day when we were... Oh. He must see how my face falls at those words because his face falls too. Carter has never tried to talk about what happened. Maddie sort of brought it up once, asking how I was doing, but she was deeply uncomfortable. Ever faced it head on, but they approach everything that way. And even then, I couldn't tell them all of it. This is why I don't want to be here. It's not just what happened between Leva and me. The group fell apart after I got into that fight. We'd barely gotten used to Zach leaving. We were picking up the pieces. And instead of heading back into the game, I led us straight to an awkward 3-month hiatus that everyone's pretending didn't happen. I can't help but think I don't belong here anymore. No matter how much I used to once upon a time. No matter how much I'd give to belong once more. It's okay, I lie. We're all together and that's what matters, right? We have to try, or at least pretend. After all, isn't that what the whole weekend is about? Pretending? We're only here to fall apart again. Carter tugs at a strand of his sand-colored hair. He doesn't meet my eye. I'm sorry, dude. Yeah, me too. Maddie glances back, her lips set in a worried line. But Ever and Leva haven't heard us and forge on ahead. One day, Leva and I will have the conversation we need to have, but it won't be today, and I won't be the one to instigate it. I meant to ask, are you looking forward to college? Just like that, Carter has changed the topic, and something has subtly shifted in his face. He's bottled his vulnerability, put his mask back on. We all have our secrets, of course. Carter's is that beneath it all, he actually used to be a decent person. I nod. You're going east, right? Carter's father taught him to be in control of conversations, to always have the last word. This version of Carter never quite knows how or when to shut up, and this conversation is just another reminder of everything that's changed between us. Once, we were close enough that he wouldn't have had to ask this. Drexel University, one of the best game development programs in the country, and the one that offered me an almost full-ride scholarship. Plus, it's about as far as I can possibly get. I want to be safe, and here isn't safe anymore. Carter huffs with the effort of dragging his ludicrous bag. Poor guy. He couldn't possibly have anticipated we'd have to abandon our cars on the private drive because of a blockage, but he looks ridiculous. I'm headed in the opposite direction, USC. I can't wait to get out of here. This town, this state, is getting too small for me. I want something that challenges me. Somewhere you can prove yourself? My tone is harsher than I intended. This version of Carter, a bragging blowhard, brings out the worst in me. I take my eyes off the path and glance up at him. He shrugs. Yeah, I want to prove myself. Something wrong with that? Having ambition isn't a bad thing, is it? I want something more, something better than all of this. Can't argue with that. The path winds sharply to the right, and I have to focus on where I place my crutches and my feet. The pine trees to my right seem to climb farther up the mountainside, as though they're shying away from the steep drop on my left, and honestly, I can't blame them. But when I turn the corner, I curse. The path is blocked by another barricade of boulders that reaches almost as high as we do. A tree has cracked and is leaning on the boulders. Brack, this wasn't here yesterday either, Ever says. They must have slid down the slope during last night's storm. We'll have to climb over. Do you think you two can manage? They turn and glance at Maddie and me. We'll climb over first so we can help you on the way down. We're only an hour into the trip, and already things are going sideways. I shouldn't have come, but I tense my jaw. I'll be fine. Something like anger or disappointment flashes in Ever's eyes, probably both. They hate it when I refuse to accept help. Do you need a hand? Carter offers, already reaching out to me. I shrink away from it. No thanks. It's better if I find my own way across. I can't trust any of them not to let me fall. Sure, your call. Carter falls into step with Maddie and offers her his assistance instead. She nods gratefully. She'd gone pale at the sight of the boulders. After this trek, her knee must not be in great shape either. The road, which leads up to a cabin nestled snugly in a grove on top of Lonely Peak, used to be clear. But bad weather, climate change, and an honest eldritch god's mudslide have recently put the last few miles out of commission. I'm sure Leva's family will pay to fix it at some point, but they haven't yet. Ever and Leva make their way across first, holding on to the tree for balance. The boulders, all different sizes, don't seem to be particularly stable, and there's a small voice in the back of my mind, one that sounds remarkably like my therapist, telling me I should accept the offer for help. After 3 years of PT and occupational therapy, 5 years of hospitals and arthritis specialists, I know exactly where my physical boundaries lie. I'm just incapable of admitting they exist. And they keep closing in on me. Your mind is playing tricks on you, my friend Damien would tell me. Asking for help isn't weakness, and limitations aren't a weakness either. They just are. So, what should I do with them then? I'd ask him. He'd ruffle my hair. Accept them? And yourself? I know it's difficult. I know the rest of the world teaches us differently. But you're not lesser because you're different. You don't have to push yourself into an uncomfortable mold to be considered acceptable. But instead of speaking up, I wait for Carter and Maddie to cross too. They make their way gingerly, but as the rocks shift beneath them, small pebbles are sent flying over the edge, down a steep cliff. I focus and listen, but I don't hear them fall. It's an endless drop and a harsh silence. Then, it's just me. I realize what a terrible decision it was to wait until last. Finn, are you sure? Ever says from behind the rocks. I'm worried about you. That settles my resolve, and I take the first step, climbing on one of the smaller boulders. It shifts and moves under my weight, but up is relatively easy. It's going over that's the problem. Without sure footing, all I can do is place my crutches first, one step, then the next. From this boulder to one higher up, a rock that looks a little more steady, another step. I lean hard on my crutches, because it's the only way I can keep my balance. But that makes it hard to ignore how shaky they feel, how tangles of pain shoot up through my legs every time my feet slip, every time my ankles overextend. I'm a fool. On the other side, someone shouts something, but my world has narrowed down to these rocks now. Whatever they say, it's not louder than the blood pumping in my ears. I reach the highest point. The fallen tree hangs over the rocks, allowing the narrowest of gaps. I'm going to have to fold myself through it, like the others did, and somehow catch myself on the other side. I put one crutch through, then lean on the rocks and follow with my head and shoulders, ignoring the pain. I turn sideways, one knee first, so I have a way to brace myself. Then pull the next crutch and try not to launch myself down, continuing to ignore the pain. I find a good place to put the crutches and turn all the way through. When I tug my foot free from the branches, I nearly lose my balance, but I manage to catch myself and stabilize. Another step. And I feel the crutches slip out from underneath me. I don't know if it's the rocks that shift or if it's my own lack of stability, but it's as though time slows down, and I can feel myself fall, oh, so slow. Then, My knee buckles. My ankle twists. With the elbow cuffs around my crutches, I can't reach out to stop myself because the impact would destroy my shoulders. I can only close my eyes and let myself collide. Strong arms come around me, bracing against my downward momentum. Then, other hands join the first person, holding us up and slowing us down to a stand. I hardly realize I'm not falling anymore because the world is still twisting around me, and I may have messed up my hip again. Finn, Ever's voice comes harsh and angry like punches. You fool of a took! Ask for help when you need it. Firmly on the ground, I open my eyes. There are manicured nails around my arms, with the symbol of Gonfalon, a stylized golden G, delicately painted on each one. I nearly flinch. Don't! Out of all my friends leaping up to help me, why was it Leva who succeeded? Pain burns in my ankle, but my anger burns hotter. Leva lets go of me and steps back. Ever is directly behind her, glaring at me. Carter frowning. Maddie pale with worry. I'm reeling with fear and fury and hurt. And it's so much, so overwhelmingly much. I don't know how to deal with it, but to sink down and sit and ground myself. Breathe until I get my equilibrium back and my hands don't tremble with rage anymore. Wait until the anger, at myself, at Leva, at this cursed mountain, withdraws into the usual shadows. I thought you were smarter than that. Ever hands me a bottle of water out of their backpack. Underneath their words are others. I thought you were okay with this weekend. I am. For them, I am. Or I thought I could be at least. As I catch my breath, I glance around at the group. We are a collection of individuals, all of us broken, all of us fragile. But the thing that scares me most isn't that I might break us apart further. It's that I want to.
Chapter 2. Maddie. Finn radiates pain. He's so tense, it hurts to look at him. I wonder if he realizes it. In my experience, most people, most neurotypical people, don't. Even if they'll talk about nonverbal language and how important it is, they don't realize how unconscious most reactions are and how much they're sharing. But I do. You teach yourself how to read body language when winning a game or navigating life. Depends on it. With Finn, his tension is in the tight set of his jaw, the way his shoulders crawl up to his ears, the fingers that twist around his crutches so hard they've gone almost as white as his hair, the shadows around his eyes. Right now, he's the type of person I'd stay away from if I met them on the street, because whatever's beneath the pain feels dangerous. I taught myself to be as fluent as possible in nonverbal languages, because it's the only way to understand what people aren't saying, to carve out your space and claim it. It's the only way I can feel like I know what's going on. It's the only way to lie convincingly, too. Yes, I'm doing better since the accident. Thanks for asking. Or, oh, I'm absolutely looking forward to college after my senior year. It's going to take some adjusting since I can't count on a lacrosse scholarship, but I'll figure it out. Now that I know how easy it is to lose something you care about, I plan to work even harder to succeed at whatever comes next. Life is short, you know? You have to make the most of it. Casual smile. Subtle nod. Relaxed posture. Make sure to turn toward the person I'm talking with. Maybe mirror their posture. Mirroring is a bit more complicated than literally copying someone's body language, but it does put people at ease. Maybe I should teach Finn some of the tricks. Because Ever's nostrils are flaring and they obviously don't believe Finn's okay. Finn hands the bottle back to Ever and scrambles to his feet. Let's keep moving, Ev. Fine. They pack up and stalk toward me to offer me a hand. Come on, only a little bit farther. I steel myself before I allow them to pull me up. I don't like it when people touch me. I don't like it when I'm observing a conversation and it suddenly turns to me. And I don't like the sharp stab of pain when I rest my weight on my leg again. We're a bit of a mess, aren't we? I mutter. We all fall into formation as we keep moving down the path. Leva and Carter leading the way, Ever and me in the middle, and Finn behind us, quietly stewing. Once we've settled into a rhythm again, the pain in my knee goes from stabbing to nagging. No more than we should have expected, I guess, Ever says. They're putting up a facade. Both Leva and Ever put a lot of work in this getaway, in different ways. I just want this weekend to be good, you know? I want everything to go exactly right. Once we've found our way back into the game, it'll be better, I say. I don't think this weekend will fix everything, but it'll be good to spend time together. We've been playing this role-playing game together for 3 years now. We've overcome and adapted to Zach bowing out. We managed, sort of, without Finn. Returning to it now will be as natural as getting back on a bike, I hope. Ever draws the straps of their backpack tighter and straightens their t-shirt. They're nervous. You know, Leva and Finn are going to have to talk sooner rather than later. I know. I bite my lip and glance at Leva's proud posture as she's leading the way. That'd be good. They wouldn't even have to mend things forever. Just for this weekend. None of us know what happened with Leva when Finn got beaten up. She was there, but wasn't part of it. She wouldn't be part of it. But she hasn't found a way to talk about it with any of us. Even me. And none of us have figured out a way to talk about it with Finn. We just know that ever since that day, there is bad blood between them. And it's threatening to push all of us apart. We used to meet up every week. But since February, we're happy if we make it once a month. And Finn hardly showed up for any of the games. I reach up to curl my hair around my fingers before I realize the long black locks are gone. Cut off in a fit of wanting and needing and different. No more Maddie the injured lacrosse player. No more Maddie who got trapped in a burning car. No more, did you know Maddie is actually special? No more pain. No more uncomfortable layers and masks that I never wanted to begin with. The corner of Ever's mouth pulls up. I like the hair. Thanks. I hate it. And I'm not the only one. When Leva showed up at my house yesterday without warning, while I was trying to make cookies for the weekend, she very nearly strangled me. If you told me you planned to get a haircut, I could have changed your costume, she snapped. You should look like an inquisitor. You need to do the magisterium proud. I didn't get a haircut, per se. It wasn't a particularly well-planned decision. It just happened. It just happened. With scissors and hair clippers in front of a bathroom mirror in a haze. I felt a flash of something like satisfaction at her obvious disappointment. Even if I'd shared that disappointment only hours before. Leva shook her head. I like things to be pretty. I want us to look pretty. It's the last time we'll be together like this. The few words fell heavy between us and remained there. She sat at the kitchen table and took out her sewing kit, every movement measured and careful, like mine once were. You used to understand how much this means to me. The words were soft enough that I wasn't sure I was meant to hear them. Her shoulders dropped, and she kept her eyes on her designs, while my cat leaped on the table and curled up on one of the pieces of fabric. It was true. Once upon a time, I would have consulted Leva before making any changes to my appearance. After all, Leva practically pops up when you do a Google search for the societal standard of beauty, as I'd always been taught. Long, wavy blonde hair, pale blue eyes, translucent white skin, cheekbones sharp enough to cut. Leva won Wyvern Con's costume contest 3 years in a row. She was born to be a famous costume designer or a set designer, and she shines when she's creating. Once upon a time, I would have gone to her first because I loved looking beautiful too. But that was Maddie before the accident. Maddie after the accident was about to mess up her fourth batch of cookies. I kept trying. Less chocolate, more nutmeg, more cinnamon. Octagonal shaped, like a 20-sided die. But none of the cookies darkened to a crisp gold. The kitchen started to smell more and more acrid, leaving me increasingly out of sorts. I had only ever been able to approximate Nan's recipe, but whatever secret ingredient she used eluded me. "It's patience, my lamb," she'd tell me. Or trust, or love, or something else both intangible and immeasurable that left me feeling antsy and on edge. I reached my arms behind my head and popped my elbows, and tendrils of pain tickled down my arms. Not bad enough to hurt, just there enough to remind me of my body, my here. Right after the accident, the physical pain was the worst. My knee felt like it was 4 times the normal size, and my leg could barely bear weight. But it didn't stop there. It gnawed at me from the inside out, as if my knee had melted to the bone in the fire and continued to burn, even when there was no fire in sight. With every passing day, it left me more ragged and uncertain, until I didn't just struggle to understand the world around me, I struggled to understand myself. "An opera cape," Leva said after a long silence. "I'll change your cloak into an opera cape. You know, with one of those high collars. It's far better than a hood. It'll bring out your eyes and your pixie cut." She'd already laid out the design of my cloak across the countertop, a pencil at the ready. "I may have to change the shoulders a bit so you won't look like a 1950s Dracula, but you don't mind that, do you? I'll keep the length because I know you like it." I turned away from her and tried to rescue the cookies that had managed to blacken despite my careful watch. "Sure, do what you think is best." "What is best?" The kitchen door slammed against the wall, and a 5'10" perfect storm blustered into the kitchen. Sav, all smiles and muscles and long black hair. She had a ball clamped under one arm and was furiously texting a friend with her free hand. As of next season, she'd be the new defender of Stardust High School's lacrosse team. After I tore my ligaments, she took over my place in the team and in my other friend group, and kept it. "Still training?" The words bit more than I'd intended. She collected food from various cabinets. "Just finished up. I need to prepare for camp next weekend. Lacrosse season doesn't end because school's out. You remember, don't you? I only have a few weeks left to get in perfect shape to impress the girls from out of state." Those words bit more than she probably intended to. Sav worried about my injury. She was with me every day when I was in hospital, and she couldn't help it that she had a neurotypical flair that I never possessed. But every jab felt like pain regardless. Lacrosse was what had given me meaning, what had made every day a little bit brighter, and now it was gone. "You're going to do your roleplay thing again this weekend, right?" Before she slipped out again. Cheese and vegetables and a container of hummus balanced on a plate. Sav glanced at Leva's work. "Cool. I can't wait to hear the stories. I hope it'll be great. Also, Mad, if you try another batch of those cookies, save me some." With a teasing grin in my direction, Sav pulled the door shut behind her, and her voice echoed in the hallway. "They smell delicious!" Before the accident, BTA, I didn't know anger and pain could feel the same. I didn't think physical pain and emotional pain could simply be extensions of each other. Now I could hardly separate the two. and I wanted to crash my fist into a kitchen cabinet or my knee into a chair. Find a more harmful way to stim. Either make the pain worse or make it go away. Instead, I swayed back and forth and started batch of cookies number 5, only to find the dough confused and the cookies burned again before I realized what had happened. I couldn't even remember putting them in the oven. Maddie? Behind me, Leva was packing up her design. Smile tight, a frown across her brow. I need to stop by Ever's, so I'll finish the cape at home. Maddie? I thought I'd answered her. Maddie! Ever's voice draws me back to the present. I blink and see them stare at me, shoulders hunched inward, head to the side. I blink again and clear my voice. Sorry, zoned out, I guess. One of the reasons why I actually hate the haircut is because I can't hide behind my bangs anymore. So I can't glance at Ever and the rest of them to orient myself. I can only stare around me and wonder. We're nearing the grove where the cabin is. I feel like I missed the entire second half of the walk-up. My knee screams at me, but even that didn't draw me from my haze. My hands curl into fists inside my pockets, my fingers grazing what's inside. I need to be careful of these moments. They're happening too often, and I feel like I'm losing myself. Ever reaches out a hand to me, but right before touching my arm, they hesitate and keep a careful distance between us. You know you can talk to us if you need to, right? You can talk to me. What would I say? I lost the place where I didn't have to think about who I need to be, a place where rules were clear and I excelled at them. I lost nearly everything I care about by simply trying to stay afloat, and this weekend, I'll lose the rest. Thanks. I'm just saying, when the others go off to college, we'll still be here. We won't have the game anymore, but we don't have to lose each other. You can talk to me. You can trust me. They stare away from me, toward the grove and the cabin, which is still nothing more than a large shadow amidst the trees. Like with Finn, I don't think Ever realizes quite how obvious their body language is. In-game, their poker face is fantastic. Here, they're broadcasting their nerves, their worries, and the fact that they're lying through their teeth right now. I slowly unclench my hands and wrap my arms around my torso. I know, and I appreciate that. Let's get through this weekend first, see how everything goes. They nod. Then a hesitant smile breaks through on their face. You do have a murder to solve after all. I plaster a smile on my face too, nod in the direction of the cabin. So, here's hoping we will, and that we'll survive the weekend in the process. I hope you mean in-game. Well, we do have a cabin in the woods. Isn't that asking for trouble? Ever hikes their backpack a bit higher up their shoulders. Ah, yes. The oh-so-idyllic, ultra-modern cabin of the Koenig family. Ghost stories aside, the only trouble we can get into is accidentally locking ourselves in or out. Leva allowed me to set up here yesterday, and it may be the most high-tech cabin I've ever seen. Stray bears could make their way through those doors. They're all so well-locked. Leva's dad is always worried about her safety. I hate those locks. Still, the smile comes easier this time. Ever's right. The cabin is a modern fairy tale sort of place. And over the years, Leva and her parents kept refurbishing and modernizing it. BTA. And despite all the ghost stories, Leva and I spent countless nights here. She told me she'd keep me safe from the ghosts. Now, I need to survive the weekend on my own terms. I never did bring the cookies.
Chapter 3. Leva. From the outside, my cabin looks like any other in these mountains. Endless logs and a small, well-crafted porch with a door that leads to the large living room spanning pretty much the entire first floor. aside from the narrow kitchen at the back. A wooden staircase winds its way up to the second floor, where small guest rooms line the hallway, with a single decently sized bathroom at the back. It was built for simplicity, but my family added a sense of modernity. But most of that is hidden away. It's not until you get close that you can see that the door, with cute wind chimes hanging in front of it, is reinforced and the windows are insulated. And inside, everything from the heating to the kitchen appliances runs on fully automated systems. What can I say? Mom liked luxury when she still came up here. And while Dad despises unnecessary expenses, or emotional expenses, he always did everything for her. Now, Mom spends most of her time in Miami, and the cabin is all mine. I take better care of it anyway. Well, except for the road leading up here. I respect the history of this place. With a little help from the internet and Dad's credit card, I redesigned the large living room and kitchen after Mom left, bringing in all the original elements again, like the comfortable couches around the electric fireplace and the thick rugs. I reorganized the 5 bedrooms, giving them all their own subtle themes: forest lodge, seaside mystery, haunted mansion, lava flow, and my room, of course. I stayed here long weekends with Maddie and with Zach, back when he wasn't an arrogant ass yet, and we were still dating. By the end of it, he knew this place as well as I do. Although as far as Dad was concerned, those weekends were spent with Maddie, too. Being here feels like coming home, and I love inviting others to the cabin and allowing them to appreciate the luxury, too, if only because it's interesting to see how they react to it. I go to unlock the door, and Maddie eyes it with suspicion. We visited right after Dad had everything installed and the wires tripped, locking us in for almost an entire day before help could come. It was Zach, of all people, who got my SOS first and who managed to hack through the door. He'd smirked once he got us out. You should know better than not to have an exit strategy, Liv. Before you know it, you'll get caught in someone else's game. Now, once the door opens, Maddie breezes through, barely glancing at the living room before making her way upstairs. She's always had the same storm blue room, even if Maddie's changed since the car accident. That hasn't. Carter comes up next to me outside the front door. This place is beautiful, he breathes. I feel a flash of satisfaction. Thank you. When he looks at me, he looks almost hungry. He's not in love with this cabin, he's in lust. I can't believe you don't spend every weekend here. I shrug. I've considered it, but I do have to put in my assistant hours at the company. You know how it goes. Carter kicks his suitcase. Yeah, I know. I smile, thinly. Parents and expectations. We both have to deal with them. Come on, I say. Let's go see what Ever did with the living room. Inside is like a whole different world, as if we crossed the threshold and truly entered Gonfalon, City of Mages. Ever took the normal aesthetics of the cabin and expanded on them. As a creator myself, I appreciate that. They have an eye for detail. It's everywhere, in the signs that hang over the doors, indicating they're still locked, the chalk markings on the floor, the locks strewn across the table. They took a wooden staff and a wooden sword and mounted them on a plaque above the fireplace. It frankly looks a lot better than the deer head that usually hangs there. The one accessory that Dad never let me get rid of, because he shot it himself and he wanted it to be a reminder of the fragility of life or something like that. Small mechanics and wind-up toys clutter the windowsills. The chairs are draped in covers I made years ago. Mossy green, with the seal of the Gonfalon City Council cross-stitched along the edges. It's the same seal I've included in all of our costumes. A parchment scroll with a stylized golden G. The same kind I have drawn on my nails. The G signifies we all belong together. At least for a few more days. It can't last. I know that. I know that. It's a miracle it lasted so long. But that doesn't mean I'm ready to give it up yet. This group of friends has taught me so much about myself, about who I am and where I fit in. Dad would tell me attachment is a weakness, but they made me stronger. And until I have to let go, we're together, like we were when it started. Finn leans his crutches against a chair.
Wow, Ever.
You like it? Ever whispers. I turn to them. You're a wizard, Ev. Finn nods in agreement, and I see the sparkle that used to always be in his stormy blue eyes. His hesitant smile is bright enough to light up the room, even if the rest of him is still cautious and uncomfortable around me. I can't help but feel a disconnect, too. Before Maddie, Finn was my best friend, but I didn't have access to the cabin yet. Seeing him here feels like two worlds colliding, and it leaves me unsettled. Next to Finn, Ever's trepidation makes them look small as they stare at me. I hope you don't mind my messing with the decor this much. Of course not. Even after 3 years of playing together, I don't know how to make them feel more at ease about my family's money. I know the differences between our situations are stark, but that's hardly my fault. I share what I have whenever I can. Isn't that enough? A familiar sense of impatience gnaws at me. I told you to make yourself at home here. My words have hit their mark, and Ever flinches at the frost in my tone. Then, they square their shoulders and plaster on a smile. They know as well as I do that I can't help that we live in different worlds. Can you believe it's been 3 years? No. Well, yes. We were young and naive when we started playing together. I was nervous when I walked into the school theater on our first day, and I never had anything to be nervous about in school except, perhaps, making the best decisions for my social status. Joining a role-playing group wasn't necessarily one of those decisions, but there were reasons I did it. The joy of playing. The people. Family. Finn, we were still close. When he extended the invite to me, how could I say no? He looked so different then. All angles and anxiety. He was the quiet middle school kid who might be a math genius, might be a programming mogul one day. In the years since, he's come into his own. All of us have. Maybe that's part of what makes it so hard to keep the group together. When we were just starting, the lines were easier, the conversations less uncomfortable. Ever designed our Gonfalon adventures and pulled the group together. They created a world where they were powerful while living in a town that would do everything to drain that power. That day in the theater, they welcomed us with a story and a flourish. I was hooked from the moment they started describing Gonfalon. It's the biggest city on this side of the Scarlet Sea, where ships from all the seafaring nations dock, so merchants can sell their wares. Where education and medicine are respected and thrive. Where the council works hard every day to make the city safer, more prosperous, and able to withstand any disaster or war. They call it the City of Mages, and many think there is magic itself in the air. It's a safe haven for magic users who were shunned or turned away from their homes, which means Gonfalon is rich with cultures and stories from all across the continent. Still, the city is far from perfect. The crime rate is low, but not non-existent. Powerful factions strive to gain influence, and the underbelly of Gonfalon is rife with corruption. The council does all it can to keep the peace, but despite their dedication, it's proven impossible to keep the city safe entirely. And that's where you come in. You're the inquisitors of the council, sent out when there are crimes and mysteries to be solved. They leveled us all with a stare and a smile. Your journey always starts with a murder. There were six of us then. Carter, who got dragged into the game by Maddie, whose younger sister happened to be good friends with Ever's sister. Something like that, anyway. I didn't know Maddie yet, but I knew of Maddie. A bit different, and an athletic star on the rise. We became friends through the game, despite her being a freshman to my sophomore. Me, Finn, Ever, and Zach. Because Zach did everything I did, and I did everything Zach did. We should have been too young to be the it couple of Stardust High, but somehow we were. He was a rich kid, like me, with generations of oil money in his family, like the insurance money in mine. He wasn't athletic enough to be a jock, but he more than made up for that with his parties. Pool parties, dance parties. That time his family rented the whole Stardust Diner for his birthday, and he invited our entire grade. He loved being the center of attention, and his generosity made up for most of his other flaws. Everyone wanted him, and I had him, at least for a while. Zach in my presence meant no one could look down on our game, even if the food chain at our small high school still structured the world according to ancient tradition. Athletic students, rich students, straight white students, everyone else. The six of us spent every Friday afternoon together, and we fell deeper and deeper into the secrets of Gonfalon. We'd pause in the hallways at school to discuss theories. We met up in the diner. We lived in two worlds at once. Zach never quite fit, though. The game didn't include as many battles as he wanted. He had to share the spotlight. Ever and Finn didn't take kindly to his biting humor, calling him out on his not-so-politically correct.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.